Just going through the setup, making sure everything is correct here. I think that's right. Audio settings are set up for Formula E, not this. I'm gonna go back to the pits and try that again. Car, you've got some pretty strict per lap energy allowances that greatly promote using the full coast. that doesn't exist in this. Alright, so this is going to be the flyer that... what not to do. That damn Formula E car. I'm wondering how fast this lap is going to be. Slower. I was afraid of that. Thank you. 05611. That's pretty quick. that's nice. The laptop that I was displaying Twitch chat on decided to reboot. I didn't want it to reboot. This is not going to be a good lap, so I'm going to go back to the pits, and we're waiting on 9 cars to finish qualifying. I'm actually going to pull up event viewer because I'm not certain what that was about. Seemed rather sudden. Almost like a blue screen. Last shutdown success was false, last boot success was true. System shutdown was unexpected fun. Okay, so we're on the grid, so let me load my race setup. All the LMP1 hybrids are weird looking. Medium, 68 liters. Change those to medium. I'm going to take that up to 20 liters. And we're going to change to soft tires on the last stop. Let me actually save that strategy. Really, starting is just a matter of floor it and just dump it in the first. Just some love taps. Get some places. Actually, you want weird looking. Look at the 2016 specification Audi R18. Come on, get out of my way so I can do this. Ugly as fuck. The arrow... worked. The problem is that because it was so complex, what would happen is on these long endurance races, you have a lot of rubber being thrown off the tires of all the cars. And that rubber would very easily clog all sorts of passages on that car and screw up the aerodynamics and the cooling. They were going to revise it for this year, but it was an Audi diesel, and there's problems with Audi diesels. So instead, they canceled the entire program. Yeah, because Dieselgate was kind of... yeah. And Audi was running a diesel car, and yeah, that wasn't gonna... And Audi wrote the code to do the cheat. Yeah. What wasn't entirely expected was that Porsche was also owned by Volkswagen. Their last race in this class with the 919 was this year. It was believed that, especially after they won some plug-in hybrid rules for the 2020 rulebook, that they would stick around, but no, they didn't. So now, for 2018-2019, because they're doing a season and a half. It's going to be the Toyota TS050, the next generation of the car that I'm driving here. Which, same idea, but... instead of a 3.7 liter V8, it's a 2.4 liter turbo V6. And it has a battery instead of a supercapacitor bank, storing the energy. Interesting that I'm catching these two cars. And Porsche in front of the Audi is the slower one of the two. Which is really interesting. But yeah, it's going to be the Toyota is the only manufacturer entry. They're tweaking the rulebooks to bring non-hybrid private teams into better contention. And there's a shit ton of those. Some confirmed, some strongly rumored. There might be 10 cars of this class on the grid next year, which is huge. that Audi off the line, it has higher top speed. So I have a lot more hybrid power, and the way the hybrids use their energy is they get explosively off the line. But top speed ends up being 11. I got a nice toe. And I bent some suspension doing that. Not badly though. Crack the windshield. Definitely feels a little different. Apparently crashed a car out. Yeah, it definitely doesn't feel right. Well, I'm stuck with this for another... I think it ends up being 26 laps. Actually, no, I'm not. No, I'm not stuck with this for another 26 laps. I'm stuck with this for another 16 laps. I don't care about the smashed windshield. Or even the fact that I've lost my front wing. I had that on minimum downforce anyway. This does affect my race strategy, though. My planned tire allocations aren't going to work the way I want them to. So I won't have softs for the end of the race. And I'm definitely losing pace to this. I can feel the car feels worse. Tire wear too. As I can see on the tire temperatures on the front, they're not even. Yeah, that corner's a second or third. I had to go to second. Toyota behind me that really wants past me. And I don't want to let that happen. I want to hold on to the place. Maybe I did need that downforce. Front end doesn't feel amazing in slower corners, but it feels okay. It's faster corners where it is feeling a lot worse, so, yeah. Wing one does still help the balance of the car, apparently. just going to serve that penalty right there where I can kind of back things up. Well, yeah, so when this car is going down the Kemmel straight, when I'm manually telling it to give me maximum hybrid boost, it has 1,000 horsepower. It has 1,000 fucking horsepower. Actually, a good driver of the car in this condition could probably be turning 3 or 4 seconds better than I am. I haven't actually lost that much pace. So my last lap was a 209 with all this damage that I'm carrying. So yeah, this car is 850 kilograms, I think is what the rules say it has to be, or it's the minimum weight, and 1,000 horsepower. And plenty of downforce, too. So 850 kilograms is going to be like 1,900 pounds, somewhere in there. I saw that Porsche coming and was figuring he was probably going to give me some trouble. So these things in practice, at Le Mans, which is the track that they're really designed for, their top speed is only in the 320-330 range. The next class down will actually hit 340. They only have 600 horsepower, but they're running a lot less downforce. And they deploy their power completely differently. So they're deploying 600 horsepower the whole way down the straight, whereas these are deploying 1,000 for a few seconds until they get up to speed, and then they're using 500 to just hold at their top speed. The other thing that affects the speed trap numbers is where the speed traps are at Le Mans. These cars are already coasting, in reality, with how you have to drive them. Served right as we're catching GTE traffic, which is a good time to serve it. So the fastest that I've driven in a competition situation, well, the highest speed I've attained in a competition situation was I touched 70 in an auto, 70 miles an hour in an autocross. So what, 110 or something? A little over 110 kilometers an hour. That was close. And I did that in a Miata that was running on 3.5 cylinders. 70 in an autocross, and I did it in the slowest car there, as far as power, by far. It was funny, they designed this track, it was with the Buckeye Miata Club, so they designed this track, some guy trailers in his, Caterham 7 with a 260 horsepower 2-liter naturally aspirated engine. He puts Hoosier slicks on the thing. He did not get fastest time of the day, but he had a riot. But he was like, okay, if your track's, because this is like the first one of the Buckeye Miata Club autocrosses he showed up to. He's like, okay, if it's like this, I'm gonna bring my 911. He has like a 550 horsepower 996 911 turbo. Someone who actually has a Miata did the course that time, and it was actually so tight that there was one chicane that the ass end of the Porsche did not fit. So every time through, he hit a cone. He was not amused. Like, that was the time to bring the cater. Yes, I totally just punted that Corvette. I don't care. But that one time that I autocrossed my own Miata on that really fast track, the only thing that saved me from slowest time of the day was someone brought a Pontiac Grand Prix and hustled the shit out of that thing, but W bodies are not meant for autocrossing. No, it was just the straight 3800, no supercharger. .4 was overhead cam, right? Which actually I think would end up hurting you in an autocross because higher center of gravity. And heavier. It's actually funny. The Corvette GTE race cars are running an engine based on the LS engine. So it's still pushrod, 4.5 liter V8. So they've massively de-stroked to comply with the rules. And they get some pretty significant handling advantages from the pushrod motor. To the point that some teams have complained that maybe the pushrod motor shouldn't be allowed. It's actually really funny. Conventional wisdom is, oh, you need overhead cams in a sports car because better breathing for better top-end power. Yeah, but without overhead cams, you can put a shit ton of displacement in there. Get low-end torque, still end up getting the power, still have a more compact, cheaper, simpler engine, better handling because of the lower center of gravity, and less weight. And the conventional wisdom is, well, trucks don't need overhead cams because they're revving low, they don't need the breathing, but they do need, because the reason small block Chevy still a pushrod engine still exists is because of the trucks, really. The Corvette just benefits from it. What's happening is God, this thing is so sloppy. I think I am going to pit on lap 20. That's a safe stopping point. I don't think I need to actually stop there, but so, trucks is like, oh, well, they're revving low, so they don't need the breathing ability of a dual overhead cam motor, but they do need the, they don't need the top end flow that overhead cams can give, but they do need the improved mixture in the cylinder and improved swirl that they can get from 4 valves per cylinder, which is a hell of a lot easier with overhead cams. And nobody gives a shit about center of gravity on a pickup truck, and the engine bays are already fucking huge. So you've got the interesting scenario where the sports car needs the truck engine to be at its best. The truck needs a sports car engine to be at its best, just massively detuned. So, I know I've heard rumors that GM is planning on ditching pushrods for the trucks. And the C8 Corvette, which is going to be mid-engined, is going to get the new overhead cam engine family. Or it might get like something from Cadillac or something, because I think Cadillac now has their own smaller family. It's like the 1980s and 1990s and early 2000s all over again. Hey, Cadillac has a 4-ish liter overhead cam V8, and this thing is falling apart. So lap 20. I'm still in 7th, which is one better place than I qualified. I mean, it's funny, the motors that I've seen for, like, pre-made Miata swap kits are, here is your 6-liter LS, or 7-liter LS if you want, or here's your 3.6-liter V6. I'm going to go through all the shit to swap an engine in a Miata? I know which engine family I want. What? North Star MR2. So there's a shop, I forget where they are, somewhere in Canada, that you supply them with a Mark II, Mark III, or Mark IV Golf or Jetta. And they'll put a North Star in it. But... and apparently things actually work. But the engine that I want to see someone do that with, I think it's actually more compact, is the LS4 out of, like, the later Grand Prix GT after they dropped the 3800 supercharge, or the, Impala SS that nobody cared about. But it's an it's a front-wheel drive LS. I know some people put those in the back of Fieros. And I guess they found out that some manual transmission out of, like, a Chevy Cobalt actually bolted up to this monstrosity. If you didn't want the, like, 4T65E, which is kind of weak to be putting behind a 5.3-liter V8. And it's a shitty 4-speed automatic. I know what fuel burns like in this car. It'll be the end of lap 19, beginning of lap 20 before the pit stop. Realistically, I could do it at the end of lap 17, but I don't want to have to do a splash to add, like, 3 liters of fuel. Thank you. an okay lap time, this car just feels terrible. Set up with medium tires. Why haven't I seen that much GT traffic? Unless the field is just full of LMP1s for some reason. Because I gave it basically a list of cars to fill the grid with. And then it randomly selects from those to build the grid. I didn't hand-build the grid. Yes and no. Yes, in that there are multiple classes of car on track. No, in that this game doesn't actually classify them differently. But if this were a real race, yes, there are two classes of car on track, and they're each having their own races independent from one another. But on the same track at the same time. Ah, there's a GT car. Like, up ahead, that's a Porsche 911, that's probably making on the order 500 horsepower, but it's heavy as shit, compared to this anyway. So that'll be a 4-liter naturally aspirated motor in that car. Based on the road car motor, tuned for racing. Out 210s pretty consistently. See, I could pit at the end of this lap, and I think I'd be fine. But I'm gonna wait another couple laps. Because also, running with this damage has probably affected my mileage. Which means I need to make this tank of fuel. Because I don't want to make this a 4-pit stop race. 1.226. That sector one was faster than my fastest laps per sector. The sector two will not be faster than my... And it's in the corners that I'm losing. Anyway. Because I have no downforce on them. And that's not good. These are E92s, I think, so they're going to be whatever, like, 4-liter V8s in an E92. That's a 4.5 V8 Corvette. Yeah, if the engine's too big for the regulations, sometimes you can get a waiver and just be required to run much smaller restrictors. Sometimes that doesn't happen. 4.5 is the maximum for a naturally aspirated motor, I believe. I forget what the maximum is for turbo. It's 3-point-something, because the probably whatever the Ferrari 488's displacement is my guess. Which might be like 3.8 liter. No, it's 4 liter, because that's what the Aston Martin Vantage, the new one, is going to be. 4-liter twin turbo V8. Okay, so I'm going to lose this lap, but I want to hold on to it. Body, repair suspension. Oh, that's annoying. I like how the fuel and the repairs are taking similar time. The fuel is wrong. So yeah, this early pit stop messes up my strategy, but oh god, this feels so much better. Oh god, it's still accelerating. This is so much nicer. Oh yeah, the fresh tires don't handle quite right, even though they start out at temperature. It also doesn't help that the game puts the tires on first. And then they sit there and cool off. Oh wow, that feels so much better. Yeah, I'm glad I did this early. Yeah, I don't have any actual track experience, just autocross. And really just in Miatas. I wanted, for shits and giggles, to take the Prius to an autocross. On low rolling resistance tires, just because... Well, really, I don't have anything that can hold on that's better. So this car is in, I believe, the Japanese pack. The Audi R18, I think, is in the Ready to Race pack. This one might be too, actually. Okay, fuck that corner. And the Porsche 919, which is the fastest of these, I forget whether the 2015 or 2016 is faster. I think they're actually about the same. I should bust apart the packages and see whether they are actually the same. The 2016 is in Porsche pack number 3. The 2015, I think, is in Porsche pack number 1. Don't quote me on that. This game has a lot of DLC. But I mean, there's a lot of neat cars to play with. I think I've only streamed this car and that Formula E mod. But there's a lot of shit in here. There's several Formula One cars. One 2015 Ferrari, one 2017 Ferrari. I'm gonna say a couple Lotus Formula One cars. Well, okay, there's... If you go really ancient, there's several, but... That is probably for position. Thank you. that's how you use hybrid boost to get the job done. I do recall there was a fair bit of setup to get this going. I can send you my setup, or I can send my setup, I can just post it on my server and drop a link to it somewhere. There's also the Logitech setup, but that's pretty simple. The general rule to the Logitech profiler is centering spring disabled, everything at 100%, steering wheel set to 900 degrees, and the game can change settings. If you do all that, you're probably good. But the game itself is where there needs to be a lot of setup tuning. And people just share their wheel setups. The trick with mine is it's got things mapped for all the hybrid stuff, because that's most of what I play with on it. Okay, this car is most of what I play with in this game. And I was quite happy when LMP1s actually came to this game. It was like, the Porsches came, and then, not very long after, this and the Audi... this has to be in Ready to Race. Because this came after the Jetta was back. It's like, fun. The only thing is that there's no official 24 hours of... Circuit de la Sarthe. And there is a third-party Circuit de la Sarthe. I apparently can't French. The track is messed up. The lines where it detects that you've gone off are not accurate, as far as I'm aware. Some of the corners don't seem to be scaled properly. That was for position. I'm back where I started. so the only thing about Assetto Corsa is it does not try to do any UI scaling. I don't know how true that is if you actually have Windows High DPI enabled. But it's neat because, like, all the HUD elements can be tiny and out of the way if I don't want them to be in the way. But it does mean that they're tiny and I have no control over that. So I've got shit like the render stats, the force feedback controller. All that off to the side and out of the way so I can see it if I need to. But it doesn't bother me because it's in my peripheral vision. Aiming for 295 on hybrid power. Hey, I set my fastest lap. Almost suspiciously sparse, which makes me think I did get a bunch of LMP1s that are just away from me. I also use some LMP2s just to get some little more mixed traffic in here. Project Cars has a great selection of LMP1, LMP2, GTE cars, but the physics engine... Well, Project Cars 2 is out. I'm not familiar with its physics engine. Project Cars 1, the physics engine's a little messy, and the hybrid simulation is there, but you have almost no control over how things get deployed. So it's really nice. Are you really trying to go up the inside of an LMP1 hybrid? Not gonna happen! Have I mentioned how much more fun this thing is to drive than the damn Formula E car? Granted, it's a hell of a lot faster too, but... I got the Formula E car to behave, but it was still not well balanced. This thing is nice. The stock setup is a little twitchy, but I think I might have taken some downforce off the front and added and took some roll bar off the rear, and it's happy. Actually, I took all the roll bar off the rear. Nice job! Thank you for that place, because that was for position. Great job, AI! You get a gold star for that one. That was fucking hilarious. Missed it. I was chasing down the 7th place car, and it got stuck. It was trying to pass GT traffic and kind of went straight on into a barrier. So, I didn't have to do anything. I just drove past the crash. And quite safely got past the GT car. Also, AI settings are 90% strength, 5% variability, so that means 85 to 95% strength is in the field, 0% aggressiveness. Because these cars are not meant to be driven like touring cars, Jose Maria Lopez. he's one of the current, well, one of the 2017 Toyota factory drivers that got a reputation for crashing a lot. Because he came from World Touring Car Championship, where running into other cars is normal. Probably is based on how far ahead it is. I don't think that's for position because of how far back I am. The other advantage of being off strategy is reduces the amount of conflict you have on the track. Especially reduces the amount of conflict you have in the pits, but you end up getting more clear air running. At least you don't really, but getting out of sequence is not necessarily a bad thing. To the point that some teams will actually intentionally get out of sequence to get some of those benefits. Yeah, you do get some more clear air running because you're not pitting with everyone else. I believe I am not on the lead lap. That was not the time to watch to see if I was on the lead lap, but the problem is the way the timing works. I'm not far off the back of the lead lap. So I'm 9.3 seconds off the car that is leading this lap. That's not terrible. Seconds off that car, that one. I don't care if it's for position or not. I want past it. Well, okay, that's obviously not. But what I mean is that. That's not for position, but I just got a lap back from it, but I know I'm not going to be on the lap. So that car is probably fourth or better. Somewhere between second and fourth. That's another LMP1 ahead. I don't think it's a Toyota. Can't tell you what it is until I get closer. Yeah, they'll have gone through a pit stop cycle, so that will have changed the order. That is a Porsche LMP1. That's the fastest kind on the track today. But if I'm catching it, that's not the strongest AI driving it. Or I think it's a Porsche. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's an Audi that I miss. That went all wrong. Thank you. That's an Audi. I forgot, I have 2015 Porsches, so they look completely different. If it were a 2016 Porsche, it would look like that. But I get up alongside it, and, oh yeah, that sounds like a diesel. That's an Audi! Shit trying to come into the pits, and it's probably going to retire. Knowing how AI retirement works in this. see ya. How has the AI not figured out that that car is immobile? That's actually going to make things really interesting. When something tries to pit, it's probably going to end up parking behind that car, being unable to move, and it retires. We might get the whole field retiring. Of course, I'm probably the next car to have to make a pit stop, so I won't be confused by that. Another 11 or 12 laps really into the pit stop. Yeah, I should have cleared that car by now. If it's still there in 10 or 11 laps time when I pit, I already have body damage, and this is going to be a long pit stop anyway for me, so I will quite have to push that car out. I mean, it's minor body damage that wouldn't normally warrant repairing, but the damage is going to take less time to repair than the fuel stop, so yeah. Fuck, there's a retirement. I hope that's the right car. In that amount of time, yeah, that is the right car. So where it was stopped, it didn't look like it was against a wall or anything, so it probably did just, like, run out of fuel or something. Coming into the pits. Went a lap too long in the fuel window or something. Position's always nice. So I'll probably fall back to 8th, maybe 9th after this next pit stop. Shit, I pulled a 2.069. That's quite qualifying pace. Fuck. This car's fast. 2.06.971 on worn out mediums? Okay. Good, that car is gone. Bounce through the gravel trap some. place, which is the first car on this lap. 5.1, 5.2 at the end of next lap. Tell the Toyota because it's the only one with any blue in the livery of the LMP1 hybrids. And in 2016 they removed all the blue from the livery. There's still ways to tell them apart. The noses look completely different on all the LMP1 cars. Lap down or getting a lap back off of that car. Hitting at the end of this lap. 31 lap stint. We'll be taking full fuel, full tires, on mediums again. And bodywork. whatever this is ahead, it's not position. I mean, I know it's a Toyota, but I don't know where it is. This must be a back marker. So this car is a 7-speed. I don't have the gearing set up right for how the traffic is working on this track. I can go into speeds where 7th is needed, but that just wastes energy. Tires, undamaged bodywork, and a full load of fuel. I'm still in 6th. I mean, I can go to 7th, but it doesn't actually have the power to pull 7th without deploying hybrid energy. So, I just don't. Because I would have to waste too much hybrid energy to get up to speeds where 7th is needed. It can. I just haven't done it. I'm not gonna claim this is an optimal setup. Actually, you can tweak the individual gears too. I think basically all I've done to this setup is disconnect the rear sway bar and remove front downforce. Oh, cool, another AI car ate shit going into the pits. But honestly, the final drive would only need to be honestly, I don't mind it the way it is. If I'm drafting something and deploying hybrid, I can go into 7th if I need to. think there were actually rumors back in the day that Toyota only actually used six gears in this gearbox anyway, even though it was homologated as a seven speed. Yeah, that'd be neat. I want official Circuit de la Sarthe. Newer, like the 2016 R18 would be nice. Either the 2016 or the 2017 TS050 would be nice. Better AI would really be nice. Maybe some real multi-class racing support. That'd be handy. Some different penalty structures. Not the whole slow down for 10 seconds to slow down to 35 kilometers an hour, but maybe drive-through, stop and goes, that kind of thing. I've downloaded it. From what I've seen in other sims, there's something off about the track layout, but it is pretty good. There's a reason I'm doing this at Spa, though, and not the mall. Just because there's some bugs in that. A couple areas where the AI line actually has a nasty bump on it. A couple areas where it's very aggressive about saying you went offline and penalizing you. I have not tried Project Cars 2. I've heard it's much improved over Project Cars 1, which I have. I have heard that they have not improved the hybrid system modeling over Project Cars 1, though, which you really need more control than all the hybrid boost in the last 10% of the pedal. I would even take them blending it into the accelerator better than they are now. Like, on a TS040 where basically half of the power is engine, half is hybrid, make 50% throttle full engine power. Instead, what they're doing is the last 10% of the throttle, at least on Project Cars 1, is your 480 horsepower of hybrid power. And that's just rough. That's difficult to control. But I greatly prefer Assetto Corsa's actually mapping of hybrid power. You can even edit the car files to edit the curves if you really wanted to. I've got a laptop off to my left showing the Twitch chat. Logitech Driving Force GT. It works. I'm not doing this seriously enough to bother getting anything nicer. That was actually for position. Awesome. Stick this time. just thread the needle through that GT traffic.
Thank you.
last forever. Is that purple subsectors? That Toyota traffic, I actually managed to get back ahead, so that was important. I held that Porsche off until it had to make its pit stop. That gave me a huge advantage because it prevented it from running away with the race. If there was any field close to it, it also backed that field up. So that was important. I'm still probably going to finish two laps down, but so I think I'm only one lap down right now. I don't have all the HUDs up to show that. Actually, I wonder. performance. Still listens big in the pit. Thank you. expecting my next pit stop to be at the end of lap 81. I'm planning on taking 44 liters of fuel, repairing bodywork, and soft tires. Softs are a bit of a gamble, but it's only two-thirds of the length of the normal stint. Actually, probably a couple laps less than that even. So, if I can turn out some crazy quick laps with those, might help pull me ahead. Be less of a gamble in my original strategy, but backed up and not going to buy a wreck on my platform. clutch of looking coast. I think it can pull an extra lap out of this stint. Which wouldn't... It's not a huge deal to get that lap on fuel. But it makes my soft tire strategy a hell of a lot less risky. One lap less risky. Bodywork repair and 42 liters of fuel going in. seconds off. ASO's lap down. Did that say 8.3 seconds behind? There might be a podium yet. Thank you. that podium. I'd be really happy with the podium. done. Fourth place. We'll wait for everyone else to finish, and then I want to see the results. If it was really only 9.7 seconds behind third, that would have been impressive. Sometimes Assetto Corsa is slow to end the race, especially depending on the timing when the back markers come by. Sometimes it takes a whole extra lap before it actually ends the race. The softs work surprisingly well. Okay, there we go. Race has ended. So, yep, I was on the same lap, but I was 58.793 seconds behind, so that time must have been gap to lap the leader. But I was on the same lap. That was on the same lap. That was a lap down, that was two laps down, two or more laps down. I think it was actually three laps down for these cars. Um, That was a DNF. That was a DNF. That was a DNF. Wow, a few of those DNF'd early. How high did GT cars get? 11th? That actually seems pretty high. Well, I'm going to go ahead and exit the race. One thing I didn't look at on the timetable was fast laps, all that. So my fast lap was a 205.117. 201.503 for the winner. That's slow. 205.883. So it was faster than the fastest AI Toyota on my fast lap. It's going to be the 919s. Wait, did only one 919 finish? Only one finished. Okay. And yes, I was two laps down. Or three laps down. So, second place was two laps down. Alright. Well, I'm going to go ahead and stop the stream, because that was a quite long race. 3.5 hours. And have a good night.